How's it everyone who's watching this? This is my 77th video on the channel, and today I am very excited to be starting another text, The Monadology by G.W. Leibniz. This is going to be a bit different from a lot of the other series, both because of the subject matter and because of the format. If you aren't familiar, Leibniz was an early modern philosopher who did much of his work in the 17th and early 18th centuries. It's difficult to fully put into perspective just how wide-ranging his work was. From inventing calculus and pioneering calculators, to setting the groundwork for modal logic and computers, few are more deserving of a title, last universal genius, than Leibniz. However, partially due to some polarizing arguments of Newton and the work of Voltaire, he occupies a strange place within the history of philosophy. Despite the breadth of his influence, it seems like Leibniz's thought is often brushed aside or overlooked, particularly in relation to rationalist contemporaries like René Descartes and Benedictus de Spinoza. In his lifetime, he only published one major philosophical work, The Theodicy. However, he is likely best remembered for the concept of monads, famously outlined in the short 1714 text that we'll be looking at in this series. Taking a radically monist position, where what Cartesians might call mental substance is the only real thing, Leibniz uses the monadology to present a very unique view of metaphysics, one that would later interest thinkers like Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari, even if they didn't fully agree with it. When it comes to how these videos will be structured, I am using the Routledge Guidebook to the Text by Anthony Saville to break things up. However, I draw from quite a few other sources for most of the content, which I will include in the description below. As one final note, because of how short the monadology itself is, some quotes will be taken from other works by Leibniz, like the Discourse on Metaphysics. Having said that, we'll be examining two other rules that underline his system in today's episode, the principles of contradiction and sufficient reason. Without further ado, let's get into it. The first of the great principles is that of contradiction. In its most basic formulation, it dictates that something is false if it contains a contradiction. To give an example, if we say that something is a triangle with four sides, it's false. Such a thing would be contradictory. However, this isn't all the principle of contradiction does. Whilst the negative aspect of proving things to be false is definitely important, it's complemented by a positive aspect that makes it possible to work out what's true. As Leibniz himself says in the Monadology,
"By virtue of the principle of contradiction, we judge that false which involves a contradiction, and that true which is opposed or contradictory to the false."
In other words, by working out that some basic statement is false and contradictory, we can state that its opposite is true. Although Leibniz doesn't cite it directly, he is drawing on what is often called the law of the excluded middle, which simply holds that either the proposition A or its negation not A is true. In another work, titled The New Essays, Leibniz outlines the principle of contradiction in more depth. He explains that it contains two fundamental assertions. Firstly, that a statement cannot be both true and false at the same time, and secondly, that a statement cannot be neither. If something is false, it's false. Nothing intermediate exists. When it comes to the application of this idea, Leibniz makes use of a principle to establish two kinds of truth, those that are necessary and those that are just contingent. The first class, also known as that of truths of reasoning, is composed of things whose negation involves a contradiction. If something is a truth of reasoning, then Leibniz holds that is true no matter what. In any possible world we can imagine, it's the same thing. This contrasts the second class, the truths of fact. These can be negated without a contradiction resulting, as shown in this diagram. Taking a step back to give an example of a truth of reasoning, a simple one is that a triangle has three sides. This is necessarily the case, since, as mentioned earlier, a triangle with four sides is a contradiction. However, if I instead said that snow is white, that is simply a truth of fact. There's nothing fundamentally contradictory in it being another color, like green or black. As you might have noticed with the triangle example, the idea of identity is quite important when it comes to things that are necessary. Calling them first truths, he discusses this in a text dated from between 1680 and 1684 of the same name.
First truths are those which predicate something of itself or deny the opposite of its opposite. For example, A is A, or A is not A.
This is mirrored by the 33rd and 35th paragraphs of the Monadology, where Leibniz explains that any necessary truth can be broken down into primitive ideas that cannot be proven outside of having the negation involve a contradiction. As we will see in the next episode, these ideas of simplicity and truths of reasoning play a central part in Leibniz's argument for the existence of God. For now though, having looked at contradiction, we can turn our attention to Leibniz's other great principle, that of sufficient reason. This is probably one of the most infamous elements of his system, as controversial as it is central. In the Monadology, he introduces it by saying,
"There can be found no fact that is true or existent, or any true proposition, without there being a sufficient reason for its being so, and not otherwise, although we cannot know these reasons in most cases."
Although this is sometimes read as a simple declaration that effects always have causes, the principle of sufficient reason is a bit more ambitious than it might appear at first. Leibniz is quite seriously saying that everything has a reason for why it is what it is. He does this to account for truths of fact, whose contingent nature means that the principle of contradiction can't really help us make sense of them. However, before we get to what exactly a sufficient reason, well, is, we need to first understand some of the specifics of Leibniz's theory of truth. As we slightly touched upon earlier, something is true for Leibniz if it is included in the concept of what it is true about. For example, it's true that a triangle has three sides because three sides are embedded within the concept of a triangle. We call this necessary because anything else would be contradictory. However, Leibniz goes even further and claims that this approach, sometimes termed conceptual containment theory, applies to everything. As he states in his Discourse on Metaphysics,
"The future dictatorship of Caesar is based in his concept or nature, and there is a reason in that concept why he has resolved to cross the Rubicon rather than stop there."
This provides one explanation for the principle, which is that the connection between the concept of a predicate, crossing the Rubicon or becoming dictator of Rome, and the concept of a subject, Caesar, is a sufficient reason. It explains the why behind the truths of fact that are contained within, complementing how the principle of contradiction works with truths of reasoning. However, it also poses a major problem, modal collapse, where everything becomes necessary and nothing is merely possible. Although this is something we'll explore more in depth later on, I think it's worth touching on now. Essentially, by encasing predicates within subjects, the conceptual containment theory of truth has things like crossing the Rubicon or becoming dictator be a fundamental part of Caesar. Yet it seems bizarre to say that it is in Caesar's concept to cross the Rubicon, while simultaneously maintaining that not crossing it was also possible. Leibniz gets around the issue by distinguishing between the finite analysis of necessary truths and the infinite analysis of contingent truths. Returning to the Monadology, is it there that he states,
"A sufficient reason must also be found in the sequence of things distributed through the universe of creatures, whose analysis into particular reasons could proceed into unlimited detail."
In the case of truths of reasoning, we can reduce them to simple identities in a finite number of steps. A triangle has three sides, that's that. Because a contradiction can be found and denied, this is necessarily true with an accessible sufficient reason. However, with a truth of fact, you can never quite get to the level of simplicity that the principle of contradiction requires. Instead, more and more details, along with more and more particular reasons, appear, leading to an endless chain that only ever converges on the identity of what it seeks to demonstrate. As a result, humans, as Leibniz mentioned in his introduction of a concept, often can't know what exactly constitutes the sufficient reason for a truth of fact. Nevertheless, that doesn't mean that nothing can. This is where Leibniz's theology comes in, which will be the focus of the next episode. For now, just note that God is said to provide the sufficient reason that acts as a basis for the chain of contingent truths. This doesn't mean that he necessitates them, but simply that God gets the ball rolling, and in his omniscience, can foresee all possibilities. In other words, there's a degree of certainty in contingent truths, insofar as God is aware of everything that has and will happen, but they are still not necessary by virtue of having non-contradictory negations. Contingency is basically maintained by necessity, which is outside the chain and yet still puts it into motion. With this in mind, it's quite literally the case that God only knows why Caesar crossed the Rubicon. Although this might sound a bit frustrating when viewed through the lens of human knowledge, Leibniz makes heavy use of a principle of sufficient reason while constructing his metaphysical system. Alongside the principle of contradiction, it leads to some fascinating places, like his claim that we live in the best of all possible worlds. As he explains in the Monadology, and as we will explore later,
since there is an infinity of possible universes in the ideas of God, but only one can exist, there must be a sufficient reason for God's choice, which determines him to one rather than another.
It's on this note that we finish our basic outline of two of essential principles that underlie the Monadology by G.W. Leibniz, having touched on some of the modal and theological aspects of the philosopher's system. As we'll soon see, contradiction and sufficient reason are incredibly valuable tools when it comes to metaphysics, even if they appear a little unassuming at first. I truly hope you enjoyed or learned something, and if you feel I got anything wrong, or wasn't as clear as I could have been, please do feel free to let me know in the comments, so I can do better. Next time, we'll most likely be continuing this text. Until then, bye.